So good afternoon, everybody. I'm David Wessel. I'm director of the Hutchins Center on Fiscal and Monetary Policy here at Brookings. But on behalf of the Initiative on Business and Public Policy, I want to welcome you to this event, and particularly to welcome Norman Lear to Brookings. He's the guy with the hat. I told him I was really glad he wore the hat, because otherwise I wasn't sure I'd recognize him. We're here today to talk about a very big issue, housing, specifically the shortage of affordable housing, the gap between the housing have-nots and haves, and the persistence of discrimination in housing nearly 50 years after the passage of the Civil Rights Act. We're going to begin shortly with a wonderful documentary. It's about 45 minutes that Norman Lear made, America Divided. For those of you who are under 50, Norman Lear is famous because he did such TV classics as All in the Family, Sanford and Son, One Day at a Time, The Jeffersons, Good Times and Maude, all of which I'm sure are available. Mary Hartman, and a few others, all of which I'm sure are available on Netflix because nothing ever dies on TV. Norman Lear, seriously, is a reminder that television can change people, and Norman Lear's television changed America. Now, I'm particularly glad that my colleague Martin Bailey asked me to fill in for him today because Norman Lear and I are both natives of New Haven, Connecticut. You don't get to say that very often from the stage. Now, I want to be clear, we had somewhat different childhoods. I'm a little younger than him. But also, my dad, who recently passed away, was a very popular pediatrician in New Haven. Norman Lear's dad, who was an inspiration for Archie Bunker, went to prison for selling fake bonds when Lear was 9 years old. So our parents' paths diverged a little bit. American society has changed quite a bit in the last 50 years. Most of the changes are for the good. The opportunities we offer today to women, to African Americans, to Hispanics are substantially greater than they were 50 years ago. But we've been reminded in the recent presidential campaign that there are a lot of people in this country who are alienated and angry. Many, not all of them, but many, for good reason. And I think one of Norman Lear's many gifts is that he has found a way to speak for and to the ordinary working people of America. And let's face it, there are a lot of people in this town of Washington who don't know how to do that or have forgotten how to do it. At an age when most people are happy to rest on their laurels and play with their grandchildren, Norman Lear at age 94 is still working to make America a better place. And we thank you for that. The film we are screening today is not about comedy. It's about something very seriously, about housing. Too much housing and too much borrowing can create a lot of trouble, as we saw recently. But too little housing is even worse. The documentary you're going to see is a fresh and compelling narrative about housing in America, and we're very glad to show it here at Brookings. For people who are watching online, the webcast will go off for 45 minutes while we watch the movie here in the auditorium, and then my colleague Aaron Klein will come back and interview Norman Lear. That'll be online and be joined by Lisa Rice of the National Fair Housing Alliance and Mark Calabria of Cato. So we're going to dim the lights and show the movie, and I'll be back in about 45 minutes.
Thank you, David. I'm Aaron Klein, a fellow here at Brookings, and honored and privileged to have Norman. I want to thank everybody for taking time out of their afternoon. What you just saw is going to be spliced and is going to be one of the main stories on American Divided, which will premiere on September 30th on the channel EPIX. So encourage everybody to tune in as they go through these different issues. Welcome and thank Sully Granitstein, who's also here, one of the executive producers, if you have other questions about the series.
It was said earlier before we saw this that this was a Norman Lear production, but it wasn't. It was a Sully Granitstein and his teammates production. They asked me if I would play the role I played, along with Rosario Dawson and Common and so forth. I was very happy to do it. But they are the creative and thoughtful and brave people who made this picture.
Norman, let me start out and ask, I mean, kind of, why did you do this, right? I mean, you've had an amazing and successful career. As David points out, you could be at home doing anything in the world you wanted to do. Why are you trudging around Crown Heights posing as
My wife doesn't want me home, darling. This appealed to me for every reason. What I did in making shows appealed to me. I fought in World War II because I thought we were 100% right, and we made promises we had to keep, and we were on our way to making them. And it disappoints me enormously. Disappoints me. It's so nothing. We are not keeping our promises, you know. And this is testimony to that. All men created equal, with equal opportunity for all. Every time you saw a little kid, a little black kid, you know that child doesn't have equal opportunity under America's promises. And it hurts. It hurts like hell.
So are you?
Just say, this is very much on my mind. Sally told me I would see this. I had not seen it before. But this landlord who would sell to me but would not, or rent to me but not rent to the that lovely GB, the black guy, when he came on camera, you know, you couldn't see who he was. And he was so blurred. Why? The answer to the why is because the network that made it doesn't want to be sued. I would, if I were running that network, I would love to be sued by that guy. That's the way this is going to make the kind of news and the kind of audience that needs to see this. He's a disgrace. That whole situation is a disgrace. And this is not putting a sensible light on it if you don't see his face. I'm just talking about that portion of it. I have 6 kids. I'm in front of 300 people.
and a webcast, bud.
I have to tell you, I lost my sister in the last year. I went to Hartford to her memorial, and her name is Claire, and I was talking to a, you know, not quite as big, but a large group of people. And the phone rang just the way it did now. And I said, I have 6 kids, and I promised my kids I would never turn my phone off. But when I answered it, I said, hello, Claire? I said, how did you find the phone there? What? Is it a cell phone? Anyway, I don't know how many people are here. The food will be fine. Don't worry about it. Anyway.
So, Nora, you created some of the most iconic characters in television history. And if Archie Bunker or George Jefferson were in America today and dealing with housing in New York, where would they live?
Well, according to everything that Sally and his team have researched and shown on camera and these wonderful people, I forget the name of the organization, Fair Housing Organization that you represent. Thank God there are some people who are seeking to put a spotlight on it, taking them to court. You heard Fred, I forget his last name, talk about winning most of the cases they won. They need 100,000 more cases, and we all need to help them get those cases before judges. But, you know, somebody once said eternal vigilance is the price of liberty. Eternal vigilance. So we were talking about this a little bit earlier. the Wells Fargo situation. You're all familiar with the Wells Fargo situation, and you know that Wells Fargo, they just fired 5,000 people who used their power and positions within Wells Fargo to screw middle and lower class people, I mean, illegally. They were fired. And their boss left the company because she couldn't stay there in that state of shame. And she was given $125 million. Did you hear me? $125 million she took away when she had to leave because she was the one running the shop when 5,000 people are paying for it with their jobs. This is our America right now. And it's not the America. It's not the America we fought for in World War II. It's not the America that won that war, that developed a Marshall Plan, that helped Europe get back on its feet, that had every reason to be so proud of itself. But what we, with the help of corporate America, did with that pride is to start to believe we were God's chosen and stopped understanding that we were just versions of everybody else on the globe, every other human being on the globe. And we did well for ourselves. But we, you know what I'm saying.
Well, you know, one of the things that always struck me about the Jeffersons was a look into how a successful African-American family still dealt with discrimination despite the fact that they'd achieved economic mm-hmm. success. They moved to the deluxe apartment in the sky.
Would you sing it?
No, nobody here wants that. But as you know, and as the show points out, more and more of these deluxe apartments in the sky are actually being owned by more and more foreign folks. That's kind of presented in an odd way as driving up the prices for
yes.
working folk there.
The apartment that you saw me in at the very top of the show was on the 53rd floor of a major building. And I had 360-degree views and so forth. And I said, who owns this? And they said something, an entity, not a person, not a name. And I said, how much did they pay for it? $120 million. Who is I kept wishing to understand who the entity was. And they showed me a strip of paper. The entity was 016J59BB73. What's the word for that, Sally?
An LLC.
Sounded like the Borg.
In another part of the world. They were parking their money in New York City by buying that apartment and screwing the rest of everybody.
So.
Sir.
Speaking of the deal.
Oh, yes. That's Sally Grandestein, who's the senior producer for this piece.
I just wanted to point out, vis-a-vis the Jeffersons, that we went to the deluxe apartment building that the fictional Jefferson supposedly lived in New York City, and we talked to the doorman, and in fact, there are no black residents there whatsoever. And it's quite a large building. And so, you know, you go to the Upper East Side of New York City, and it's still extremely segregated, so.
That's an amazing statistic. That building, you know, a deluxe apartment in the sky, not a black family in it.
So do you have a feeling that things have gotten worse than in the 70s when you were filming?
Well, worse in the sense that we've had all these years to make corrections. And we've done it with words. You know, we acknowledge and we talk and we bullshit. But clearly we haven't done it.
So I'm going to ask you one more question, then I want to bring up the our panelists and get into some of the policies here. But I mean, you live in Los Angeles,
Yes, I live here. I have an apartment here also.
That's so D.C., New York, L.A., right?
I don't mean here. I mean
you mean in New York. Yeah. New York, L.A., right? These are the coasts. These are the bubbles. These are the booms, right? Is America divided within these cities? Are there divisions between these cities that you've observed, L.A. and New York? Could I do the same story if I wanted to in L.A.? Is this a rural-urban thing? Where else do you see these divisions?
Well, you see a similar situation. We didn't hear a lot about it. Rosaria Dawson is in Flint, Michigan, where poor people are drinking water that is hurting them, not killing them. And the others are importing water at their leisure, you know, their expense, which they can well afford. And Common is doing a story in Chicago. I mean, it's a different story. It's not all the same story. But clearly, the divisions are pronounced.
All right. Well, let me take this opportunity to invite Mark Calabria and Lisa Rice up here to the stage. And while they get seated, I'm going to come on up, Mark and Lisa. Give a brief introduction. Lisa's the Executive Vice President of the National Fair Housing Alliance. She's been there for 10 years. Prior to that, she was the president and directed the Toledo Fair Housing Alliance. As Lisa is fond of telling me, the center of the universe is Toledo. Once upon a time, Lisa actually has dual degrees, a bachelor's in arts as well as in fine arts. Lisa began her career as an artist. Dr. Mark Calabria is a senior fellow at the Cato Institute. Mark has served as Deputy Assistant Secretary in HUD, thinking about affordable housing and housing policy there. He served as a senior housing advisor and senior professional economist for two chairmen of the Senate Banking Committee. Chairman Graham and Shelby, and Mark is somebody who spent years and years, like Lisa, thinking about housing policy and thinking about what we can do in terms of creating affordable housing in a way that's sustainable and works. You know, the one of my takeaways from the film were some of the affordable housing policies that we have aren't really working. So let me start. We'll start Lisa over here, and then turn to Mark. Like, where have you seen solutions that are or aren't working in how to address this critical issue of housing that working people can afford?
Well, you know, I think the challenge is that we start out with some very good ideas like inclusionary zoning ordinances or rent control ordinances. So we start out with some good ideas, but the challenge is in the follow-through and the enforcement of those ordinances. And I think you heard one of the commenters in the segment that we just watched talk about the lack of political will when it comes to actually implementing and fulfilling the full goals of those inclusionary zoning ordinances and rent control policies. So DC, for example, has a rent control ordinance. It's not, I think that there are some who would argue that it is not fully enforced and that there are lots of loopholes. We run smack dab into the face of political will when we talk about things like affirmatively furthering fair housing. There's a very famous case in Westchester County, New York, where some of the more wealthy, affluent communities in Westchester County are supposed to, under a consent decree, under a HUD settlement agreement, they're supposed to be developing affordable housing units. And the political will is not there. The political leaders have sort of voted under the pressure of NIMBYism, and those affordable housing units are not being developed. So I think that, you know, you can try to use a carrot sometimes, but on other times you need a firm stick.
So let me first say how much I'm also looking forward to seeing the rest of the series. I mean, these issues, criminal justice, immigration, others, are incredibly important and, of course, tie together in a lot of ways, too. So I certainly look forward to seeing the rest of it. I'm going to show my economist side for a little bit, and this was touched upon a little bit, but I would maybe oversimplify and explain, but oversimplify first by saying supply, supply, supply. And the predominant problem in places like New York, like San Francisco, is it's incredibly difficult to build housing. And I'll also say as an aside, and Aaron gets some amusement out of this, maybe I'm a little uncomfortable to think about watching something and finding myself most in agreement strongly with de Blasio. Not what I expected. But even in California, you look at the opposition that Jerry Brown has gotten to trying to streamline the development process so you can build units. And unfortunately, there's NIMBYism everywhere. And, you know, we recently saw, you know, two very progressive, New York City Council members vote down affordable housing being created in their own districts because they don't want it in their own districts. And I used to painfully joke when I worked on the Hill that everybody wants affordable housing except across the street. And how do you get to that? Now, I want to make a big, press too, and again, I'll quote a number that's probably 20, 30 years out of date, but I think qualitatively it's still the same, which is every new unit created, even at the top, creates on average 4 additional moves. Somebody moves into that unit, somebody moves into their unit, and somebody moves in that unit. And I think we need to get past this, and there's a little bit of that dialogue in the diner that I found interesting, but to me, I'm happy to see anything built at any price point as a starting point, because again, that supply will ultimately put pressure on prices. I'd like to see it built at all price points, but I think a lot of time gets debated about, well, you know, I don't want anything built for millionaires because they're bad people. We only want to build it anywhere and everywhere. And again, we need more housing in this country. And I'll end with saying, you know, one of my favorite parts of this, and I hope I was reading your face right at that time, was the conversation about New York being the third most segregated city in America. And of course, if you've worked on affordable housing issues, and I believe Chicago might be number one, and you know,
Milwaukee is
number one.
I've
heard Boston.
Chicago was up, but it also brings me. So if you think about the top 100 countries, and this is consistent with the Milwaukee, out of the top 100 countries, the city with the lowest African American home ownership rate, Madison, Wisconsin, which I thought was supposed to be a fairly tolerant liberal place. What's the flip side of it? Out of the top 100 cities, what city has the highest African American home ownership rate? Jackson, Mississippi. Mm-hmm. And the fact that every single city that has an African American home ownership rate over 50% is in the below the Mason-Dixon line. And the point being is, you gotta be able to build. And I think an interesting part of this story too is we've started in the last 20 years to see this movement of African Americans back to the South. Some of it, I think, is obviously that segregation is less there compared to the way it is in New York, but some of this New York situation is pushing people out who'd rather stay in New York. And of course, we're not seeing the people who don't stay, who have to move. So the point I'm getting with in all this is that places where we traditionally, again, in our mind, associate with segregation can have good outcomes in terms of homeownership or affordability when there are places where there is opportunity, where there are jobs being created, where there's housing being created. And again, to me, it's a part of a broader picture.
I'm going to push back just a little bit on what Mark just said. And I do agree that there's some supply and demand going on here. But what has happened, unfortunately, in the American marketplace is that we've allowed all sorts of dollars to influx into our housing economy and our housing market system and play itself out in a way that doesn't inure to the benefit of people who are living here in our cities and who are working in our cities. So I actually agree with you, Mark, that I think we need to develop more housing, but I'm going to argue on the side of developing more affordable housing units. We're losing 125,000 affordable housing units every single year. That's a net loss of affordable housing units. And we don't have enough capital to replace those affordable housing units. Now, we did see the first year capitalization of the National Housing Trust Fund, but that was only just shy of $175 million. $175 million is not going to replace 125,000 units.
So let me ask you, what do you mean, Lisa, when you say we're losing? Is that the housing is becoming unaffordable, or the units are becoming old and going out of service, or they're being raise to build a McMansion where there used to be working class? What is it?
All of the above.
Contracts.
It's all of the above, and we're also losing buildings that were built as affordable housing buildings and facilities. A lot of those are going to the market, and they're being bought up by investors, and they now are being offered at fair market values that are far in excess of the affordable rents that used to be charged.
And I actually don't actually think we're disagreeing all that much. I think we're disagreeing partly in the process. And so one of the things that was kind of revealed was this conversation about whether did de Blasio's plan go far enough? And so when my point about build, is it's really a point about not letting the perfect be the enemy of the good. We could stand around and say, well, okay, what's the right percentage inclusionary zone? What's right? And I'm just like, let's build it. Let's do it. Let's not wait anymore. Let's not argue anymore. Let's break ground. Let's start building.
So this is build, baby, build.
Yes, absolutely.
But if the foreign entities that are building them and the other local entities, too, are giant corporations, and they're building homes for the likes of themselves.
Well, I thought this was the most fascinating, to me, one of the most fascinating kind of tensions I thought in, and I would like to have explored, which is, ultimately, at the end of the day, the guy you confronted, the guy who discriminated, was not the big German hedge fund guy.
No, he's the guy who works for them.
Those companies were connected.
Yeah.
Okay, so that wasn't clear whether he was working for them. But the guy who was the Israeli immigrant, let me say, anybody who wants to come here from a foreign country and build 1,000 units, God bless them. That's 1,000 units of housing that wasn't there before. But what if it's
1,000 units that no local can afford?
But again, but my point before is, so are we not supposed to? Let's back it up. Let's back it up. My father was born in Brooklyn, Bay Ridge, heavy Italian neighborhood at that time. He did well. My aunts and uncles did well. I mean, I don't think I have a right to go back there and say that neighborhood have to stay Italian. Again, how do you have a welcoming city that has changed? The one thing I will draw a line so that I don't agree on is I'm not for fossilizing cities. Neighborhoods should be dynamic. Neighborhoods should have turnover. And so, again, how do you deal with and how do you make it easier? How do you do the transitions? But I don't want to lock a place in time. I'm not looking to do that.
But I spent a couple of hours in that building. We saw a few minutes of it. Everybody was black in that building, where I said I was, been there 20 minutes. And they have long-term leases. And the owners of the building, through the local who, is has an apartment in the building and runs the building, are doing everything in the world to get those people out of there, which includes causing the dust and the rubble and the so forth that are making them ill. And raising, as you heard one woman say, from $900 to $2,100. What's fair about that? American about that?
Okay. So let's start out and think about this, because I know Aaron wanted to get me a little bit to talk at rent control at some point. And again, when you have this situation where you're essentially saying to landlords, you can't build, developers, you can't build, you're going to get a shortage. We know from Econ 101 that shortages drive up prices. If you want to keep rents low, the way is to do it to increase supply. And again, to me, I'll say as a side, there was a Swedish economist, Astrid Lindberg, who once quipped that rent control was the most effective way to destroy a city, second only to bombing. And this was a guy who lived through World War II as well. And so, again, we see this repeatedly across the globe, across time, that when you have rent control, you reduce investment in the property. Again, whole lot of economic literature on this. And to me, what's profoundly, which I think the examples in the film prove, is that what you're doing is putting people in a conflictual situation. If you don't want, because it makes it like, let's think about prices normally balance supply and demand. You have something you feel is worth this. I feel like I'll give you this for this. We come to an agreement. We have a win-win. It's mutual. What the problem with New York and many housing markets is we've created a fixed pie. We've created a zero sum where we're not growing that pie so that every slice you get is a slice I don't get. That's what we've turned New York into.
So hold on. So Mark, I want to ask Lisa to respond to that, because there are two distinct questions. One is fixing the supply of the amount of housing, right, which there seems to be some more broader view that we should build more housing. We can debate how much the government should put its thumb on making that housing affordable. But then there's a different question of, if I move into a place and make a long-term commitment to raise my family, and you know, I thought one of the most compelling statements was from the woman that said, we stayed here through the crack epidemic, right? I invested myself in when this community wasn't that good. Mm-hmm. What right do they develop as a renter, not as an owner, to live there when that community comes? On the flip side of gentrification, which was dealt with but not really resolved in the piece, which is that when the neighborhood becomes good and everybody shares in that, to some degree, the landlord also kept up the building and, you know, stayed in that investment. The landlord will get a return from gentrification, but rent control depresses that and makes that process more challenging. So, you know, it is difficult to imagine in a long-term rent control where that person can get $2,000 for that unit, because that's kind of assumed that if he can push her out, he can get $2,000 for that unit. How he's going to continue to work against his own economic incentives to be a good landlord to her. Is that a realistic assumption to put the landlord into?
Yeah. Well, I think, I've seen all kinds of studies and anecdotal information that reveal how people's lives are ruined and decimated when they get pushed out of their affordable housing units. I mean, you saw the story there. It starts out with a mother and a child who have become homeless because their housing unit is no longer affordable. I haven't seen the research and the stories about landlords and owners who are homeless because of rent control. I mean, it's not there. It doesn't happen. The landlords who are subjected to rent control, as I said, most rent control ordinances have all kinds of exemptions. They have all kinds of loopholes. We hear story after story after story about how landlords can rig the system and can get more money for the apartments, the units that are subjected to the rent control. So landlords are making a living. These folks are not poor. They are not, you know, living on the edge as these families are that you've seen. And again, as you pointed out there, a lot of times these are families that have long-term investments into these communities and into the buildings. They've helped to stabilize those neighborhoods and those communities, and it is because of their sacrifice and their long-term investment that the communities are able to, in part, gentrify. But the other thing, let me just hone in on another data point. Let's focus on here in D.C. Typical two-bedroom, the average two-bedroom apartment in D.C. is just shy of $3,000, okay? That unit, a two-bedroom unit, is not affordable for the average teacher. It's not affordable for the average D.C. police officer. It's not affordable for the average D.C. firefighter. Okay, when you have a situation where your teacher and a college-educated professional cannot afford a two-bedroom apartment, cannot afford to live in the community where they're teaching our children, there's something wrong with that dynamic. And I don't think that what we're doing is causing landlords and landowners to become poor.
And
we're not robbing them of income. They're making decent incomes. What we're doing is we're robbing families, everyday families, of the opportunity to live and build and raise their families in the communities where they're working. You know, Norman talked about in this segment, you know, a lot of those buildings were not even occupied. They were vacant. And you drive all around the District of Columbia, you will see all kinds of buildings with units that are very, very high, and they're not occupied. Those buildings and those units could be occupied by the families who are living and working in D.C.
So Norman, I know you wanted to...
Well, Mark, let me ask you, the Cato Institute is known to be conservative.
Libertarian.
So there's a big difference
to the right of conservative.
When somebody says that No, actually, we'll have a longer conversation. Maybe I'll describe it this way. I was going to tie in something but I'll let you finish before.
The point of my question. Why, when you quoted a Swedish, I think, economist, who said that rent control has done more damage than bombing?
Second only to bombing.
I flew in World War II. Sure. I flew 52 missions. I bombed the shit out of Germany. So I saw bombs falling.
Sure. Absolutely.
And you're telling me, or you wish us to believe, that rent control has done more damage to people than second only.
Rent control has damaged cities considerably, and there is a whole very
second
large
only to bombing. So why, when I hear a statement like that, does the name Donald Trump come to mind?
I don't know whether you're trying to debate me, Norman. So maybe to describe the Cato position. So when the Cato position is, and someone says, well, boy, we never would have thought government would do that, like discriminate against people or, you know, incarcerate people because of their race, because they're Japanese American, like Roosevelt did. The Cato Institute says, yes, that's what government does all the time. That's what government does every day. Government shoots down young African American men in our streets. That's government. And the question is whether have we woken up and said, well, that was, you know, misguided social engineering in the 30s, and we're smarter, and we're going to do better social engineering today? Or are we going to learn our lesson not to let government run our lives? That's the difference. There's nothing conservative about it. I want people to come here, unlike Donald Trump. I'm open borders. Anybody who wants to make a better life for themselves should come to this country today. I welcome them. And I don't think the Chinese are stealing my houses.
So I think Mark, kind of, you know, I'm going to come to Mark's defense here, because there's a fair point, and the documentary does a good job of it, that shows that the home ownership ladder that was created in the New Deal and the system that was created to promote home ownership did a really good job of doing that for white Americans. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, Mark, as you were telling the story about your dad, my mom's from Jackson Heights, Queens, which is about as dynamic a place on earth as I've ever seen in terms of that. And she's, my aunt lives in the same house she and my mom grew up on. She's the, you know, old Jewish lady on the block in Jackson Heights that I can tell you is not a Jewish block. Every 5 years, it's another place. But that system allowed them to buy property and move up the economic ladder and transmit wealth, and I don't have college loans. I mean, the story that was told about that process was incredibly valuable at government assistance. And that same government process, as I thought was very powerful, pointed out that, you know, when Archie Bunker was signing the petition against multiple African Americans coming into his neighborhood, it was because he somehow had pieced together, maybe directly or indirectly, that would make his property value down in part because of the government.
That's right.
In part also because, you know, this is another area that was touched on here. There are social decisions or preferences about race that are not economic, that are discriminatory, and that last multiple generations. Right, there's a reason why these landlords discriminate. And so I guess the question I would ask, you know, to Lisa and to Norman on that is kind of like, you know, what are the solutions you've seen in which government can actually flip the scale to be good? Because Mark's point that, you know, government intervene, you know, I'm government and I'm here to help is not always the answer to communities of color. I mean, is that a fair statement?
Yeah, and I think Hannah pointed that out really well in the segment, that the policies implemented by the Homeowners Loan Corporation and the Federal Housing Administration, and most people don't know that the chief economist for the Federal Housing Administration, when it was first started, Homer Hoyt, was a eugenicist. And he believed fundamentally in racism, and that people of color represented sort of the lower echelons or the dregs of our society, and that is why they institutionalized the system of redlining that you heard her talk about. And the sad part about that is that the development, but I let me also say, because this is another point I wanted to make, that that wasn't the sort of only time, right, that our government has implemented policies that have inured to benefit whites to the detriment of African Americans. So that, when you think about head rights, when you think about the issuance of land grants and homestead grants, when you think about the whole institutionalization of slavery in America, you know, all of these policies have worked to create this wealth divide, this gap, this educational gap, and the wealth gap that we have in America. And to Hannah's point, we have put a lot of resources and energy into creating a separate America. We haven't put the same amount of resources and energy into creating a unified America and to balancing things out and creating more parity and equity in our societies. And there are lots of things that we can do. We can start with enforcing the laws that we have on our books, our fair housing laws and our equal opportunity laws, our anti-discrimination laws that we don't do enough of. In part because you see so many members of Congress who are steadily trying to chip away at those civil rights laws and rights that we have, chipping away at the Voting Rights Act, trying to chip away at the Fair Housing Act during the appropriation cycle. So there, we continue to never see a time in America where we are fully enforcing our nation's civil rights laws. We can certainly start there. The second thing I think we need to do is be serious about expanding the bandwidth in terms of affordable housing options for people. And there are a range of affordable housing options that we can make available, from rental to co-ops to homeownership. And we need to be serious about doing that. Because homeownership, let's face it, it's the key way to developing and building wealth in America for most Americans. And then we also have to level the playing field when it comes to education. We can't continue to support a system that promotes inequity in educational attainment. We can't have a system where children of color don't get access to high-quality schools and white children do.
So that's... The education point's incredibly important because it's so linked to housing when you send schools based on neighborhoods. But I want to stick with one theme on discrimination and enforcement, because, Norman, you have got to experience something that I don't think most of us, I know Lisa, you've experienced it in the room, of actually being part of a discriminatory process, of actually having to look somebody in the eye who got turned down for the same apartment that you got due to race. And what was that experience like? How did that make you feel?
Shitty. Lousy. What we don't do is face the essence of our common humanity. We showed the picture in New York last night, and I was about to say something. I apologize to the handful of people who were in both places. But, I mean, the fact of my life at 94 is hundreds, if not thousands of times, I have read about children, starving, lying about with flies in their eyes, dying from diseases in all parts of the world, including my America. I have gone to the refrigerator before going to bed, and I've had a little bit to eat, and I have slept. That's who I am as a human being. I say that with no pride at all, but I have to recognize that, and maybe I wrote a check the next day or did whatever little thing I could do, but the fact of my life is I've watched these horrors, and I'm watching them now, and all of you are more able to answer your last question, which, what would you do about it? I view myself, you I'm sure think of me as liberal, I think of myself as extremely conservative, but a bleeding heart conservative. You will not screw with my First Amendment, my Bill of Rights, my constitutional guarantees. I will die for those if I have to. But just my heart bleed for those kids that have no hope. They've been denied at the moment. We're looking at them denied every bit of hope. I don't know what we do about it because I'm not, but I would be a part of any team that was wishing to deal with it and look at it.
So Mark, I want to ask you about being a bleeding heart conservative, but I want to ask.
I thought that earned some
Lisa, I first want to ask Lisa, because Lisa, you've been on the other side of this situation, and you've had an experience in going through a discriminatory field testing. What's your takeaway?
Well, that's
from
what
that?
We do at NAFA and the Fair Housing Justice Center. You saw Fred Freiberg in the segment. Fred's group is one of our operating members. So the National Fair Housing Alliance was sort of the trade association for the Fair Housing Justice Centers of the country. And one of part of what we do is engage in field testing in a variety of settings. So we test in the rental setting, we test in the real estate housing setting, the lending setting, the insurance setting, et cetera. And we do find instances of discrimination. And in fact, about every 10 years or so, the Department of Housing and Urban Development conducts a housing discrimination study in which they try to measure the nature and extent of housing discrimination in America, you know, on sort of this every 10-year period. And unfortunately, we do see continuing levels of discrimination. But what we're finding is that discrimination is becoming more entrenched, and it's more buried, and it's much more subtle. So that when we first started doing the HDS, you know, in 1977, we saw a fair amount of blatant acts of discrimination. Today, we don't see that a lot, although we still do see it. A couple of years ago, we litigated a real estate sales test where our white tester, when meeting with the real estate agent said to him as he got in the car, "I couldn't tell over the phone if you were white or black," and I printed out two different sets of listings, and since I now see that you're white, we don't need this one, and discarded the one that he had developed if the person had been black, had been African-American. But so we do see high levels of discrimination. We see high levels of steering based on race in the real estate community. And it's steering on all segments, race, national origin, even religion. In New York City, that we think of sort of the bastion of liberality, right? In New York City, on a test, we had a real estate agent take our white tester to a neighborhood, and she pointed to a sign, a picture in the window, and she said, "That's my mother's house, and that's a picture of Jesus in the window." And she said, "So you won't find any Jewish people in this neighborhood." So people.
They're sending me to the Upper West Side?
They're sending you, yes, they're steering. So we still have high levels of discrimination. And let me just say this. Look, every single person, if you are a human being, if you're thinking, breathing, living human being, you have implicit bias. Everybody does. The key is that you can't let those biases impact your decision-making process, particularly in a business setting, in a business transaction. And that's where too many people who are working in the housing arena haven't learned to do that. And so, you know, Norman, you asked like what we have to do, and I think that other people have talked about this. I mean, we have to be willing to have open and honest conversations about discrimination, about prejudice, and about our biases and what we can do to overcome those.
Let me have some applause for Lisa. So let me first emphasize, just for the sake of the audience, there's no disagreement about the existence of any of this. The disagreement is about what is the solution. And certainly let me say myself, unfortunately, my first housing memory is my parents buying their first house in Richmond, Virginia, and renting it to an African-American family at that time, in seeing the absolute ugliness. We were good landlords. Our neighbors in that community, we thought we were our friends, were not when we moved out and rented it. And so I know that's there. But the way I think about it is, if you want to disempower the racist, if you want to take away his power, to do that, in my opinion, is choice and opportunity. The racist has power when he has a monopoly, and we crush the monopoly, in my opinion, is how you do it. And the way New York works is the housing market is a monopoly. And that's what we need to break up. Because again, when you look at it, when you look at the top 100 cities and it says that the best outcomes for African Americans are Jackson, Mississippi, which I'm gonna go out on a limb and suggest that maybe there's slightly a little more racism in Jackson, Mississippi than there is in New York. What's the difference? Maybe, I don't know, it could be that there's less. I mean, I don't wanna actually dismiss because one of the things that makes me optimistic is the amount of time I've spent in the South. In Birmingham and Jackson today are not the Birmingham and Jackson of the past. And a lot of progress has been made there, and a lot of progress can be made. But the point being, in my opinion, is how do we break the power of those who want to deny this ability to us? And we need that choice and I need that opportunity. And that's why, again, I find myself, oddly enough, agreeing with de Blasio, but I'll end with a point. As de Blasio mentioned, gentrification's a double sword. And one of the points that he did not raise that we never really hear about is, what about the benefits of gentrification for the people who have long-term owners in that community, who finally are able to cash in and get some equity on a property that they have sat on and that they've maintained? Without that gentrification, they would not be able to get that price they get. So I don't think we should forget that element of it as well. Again, it's a double-edged sword.
I was sitting with people where gentrification meant that they had to pay from 900 to 2100 and so forth, and it was impossible. And they had long-term leases, so they could stay where they were, but the landlord was doing all of these dastardly things to cause them to leave.
Well, this is this tension. I'll come back to the landlord issue in a second. But if a neighborhood's got a mixture of renters and a mixture of homeowners, the value of those homes is ultimately going to track the rents. And so if we want rents to stay stable, that means the home values are not going to go up. You want home values to go up, well, the rents are going to go up. And it is a tension. And if we think that there's going to be long-term stability in that neighborhood, then we should be looking at ways to try to get people into long-term sustainable homeownership, which in my opinion is not what we did over the last decade, and how to make sure that people can stay.
But does that mean we have to build some homes that are affordable for them?
Yeah, absolutely. And again, to me, you have to build more to bring down the price. Again, this is why I keep saying supply, supply, supply. You bring more supply online, prices will come down. I mean, it gets to what I think is the fundamental tension in federal housing policy, which is we want housing to be affordable, but we want it to earn you great returns at the same time. Those two things are in conflict. Nothing earns great returns unless it's limited. And so to me, all I was saying, you know, to go back to the California, invoke California for a second, we need a Moore's Law. Everybody knows the Moore's Law with the power of processing where it gets cheaper and cheaper. We need that for housing. I'm absolutely convinced in the right circumstances we could build a decent house in this country for $40,000 if you could fix the land prices. We know how to do it in the factories. The technologies are there. We can make affordable housing in this country.
So I know the audience has been incredibly patient for a long time. And
I'm
so
sure
let
I've
me,
given no one anything to talk
let me,
about.
Let me. I've already seen. So I'm going to try and go right to left, front to back. So we're going to go from this gentleman and then that woman over there, and then go back there. Third. And if you could just identify yourself and please ask a question.
Listen, I've been here at Brookings Institute for a long time, and typically there's very little time given for questions, or even make a statement. First, an observation. Mark has made a comparison of homeownership in the South, rates of homeownership in the South, to those in New York, for example. That's not a fair comparison. Latinos along the U.S.-Mexico border have higher rates of homeownership, but that's only because the homes there tend to be older, passed on through generations, are in constant need of repairs. So there's a difference between homes in Mississippi and New York. Second, I was struck by the rental testing in New York. The gentleman was clearly distinguished, looked to have a good income. I love his fur coat. So the problems go beyond income. They go beyond job status and even possibly beyond credit scores. So there's clearly a problem of discrimination. And the problem I would contend with Mark is not so much, and I would like for him to address this, is not so much that government is impeding efforts, but we look at Congress as part of government. They're impeding progress by keeping the levels of rental and homeownership assistance at historic low levels and not doing anything to promote mortgage finance reform.
Well, as someone who, I was just telling someone the other day that I remember it was 13 years ago that I started working on mortgage finance reform bill at that time to fix Fannie and Freddie, 13 years ago. Wow, and Fannie and Freddie are still in limbo. So there's probably nobody in Washington, well, I don't know if DeMarco's down the street, maybe he feels a little strongly than I do, that wants to see mortgage finance reform more than I do. As Aaron can attest, I put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears in that and like to see it fixed. So absolutely agree on that. One of the things that is interesting to me is, as a staffer on the Hill, I used to get this all the time, that, you know, we want resources for you. To me, I think localities need to take ownership of their housing problems. In my opinion, New York, San Francisco, these places have made policy decisions to be unaffordable, and they need to own it, and they need to fix it. And it's in their power to fix it. And again, the opposition that Brown is seeing in California, just to try to make it simpler to build, is insane to me. And the fact that the unions and environmentalists against him, I think, is just deplorable. And I mean that when I say deplorable.
On the end there, if you could give your name and your question. Thanks.
My name is June O'Connell, and I would like to direct your attention to a Brookings seminar a few months ago that focused leaders from Singapore and what they had done in order to not just integrate housing within Singapore, but to integrate economically buildings, high-rise buildings, because that's all Singapore is, and to direct your attention towards architects. And it's not just letting them build it, but high-rises are built by tiers. So high-rise developers will say, with de Blasio, for instance, we'll build 1,000 units in this building and we'll give you 100 affordable units. And they have to all be the same. So those 100 affordable units get walk-in closets and they get granite countertops. And if you argue you'd rather have 150 units of varying sizes in that same building, they will say they can't do it because of tiering. So to the gentleman from the Cato Institute, it's not just about letting builders build, but actually I suggest also pressing their architects and housing with de Blasio that there's real change, so you can have in a building people who have 30% income of affordable rate and people at 100% income. And I'd like to ask you if you've seen that done anywhere in this country.
That's a form of inclusionary zoning, right? And believe it or not, there are about 500 jurisdictions in the United States that have some form of inclusionary housing housing program. Montgomery County, Maryland is touted as...
That's where I'm from, so a lot of Maryland pride, 1972.
I am too, so I'm going to say something bad, though, about Montgomery County in just a second. Where I live, so it's okay. But Montgomery County, Maryland is sort of touted as having one of the premier inclusionary zoning programs, and that program does produce a lot of affordable housing units. And I think studies have shown that those inclusionary zoning programs do not negatively impact the housing market. It certainly hasn't negatively impacted the housing market in Montgomery County. Now, here's the bad thing I'm going to say about Montgomery County. Montgomery County does not have rent control. What the county does is it produces...
I thought you were going to say something bad about
Montgomery County. I just did say something bad about Montgomery County, Mark. It doesn't have rent control. And what the county does do is it produces every year sort of a guide, right? And it's a guide that tells landlords what they should increase their rents by, and it's based on the cost of living adjustment. But typically, landlords do increase their rents in excess of what that guide is.
If I could make a point, I mean, 100% agree that, I mean, there's probably no development that ever has been built anywhere that couldn't have been done better. And I'm all for doing it better. I worry that, especially in places like California, but we do this in Montgomery County and other places, where the process to make it better ends up a process that at the end of the day, you don't get anything built. And that's my concern. I'd rather have the unit with 100 set aside that they're all the same than no thing built at all. And that's my concern. I think that that's the truth facing the reality facing a lot of these places in America is we're letting the perfect project be the enemy, and it ends up having no project.
So, I will add that you can't build that 100 unit place in or
probably anywhere,
a 15-story building in Washington.
Yeah,
I mean, we have a height control. We don't have rent. We have rent control, but we have height control, which is, you know, immediately caps the amount of size at some point. Let me ask a question here, and then in the back row, and then we'll come over. We're working.
Sure. Hi. My name is Conway Reinders. I'm with the Oxford Poverty and Human Development Initiative. So while I do understand the supply and demand graphs, I also understand that poverty is a lived experience, and people experience not only with income, but also with health and also with housing. So my question is, if it seems like a big problem is the political viability, and how ought we try to make it more politically viable to improve housing policy, and if we have the laws in place, they're not being enforced, how can organizations like Brookings or Cato or the NFHA try to elevate that political discourse, a societal discourse, not necessarily the discourse here in Washington? And I think screenings like this film, and even I came and saw The Big Short at Brookings before, I think this is a really promising direction for think tanks to head into, and so I was wondering if this is something that you'd want to do further or on that point.
Well, let me start by thanking both Lisa and Norman for, I mean, a lot of work went into this in the National Fair Housing Alliance, as well as EPIX, and it takes a lot of collaborators in the room, and Solly and his team. It takes a lot to try and have a different discourse. In fact, if somebody out on the webcast wants to tweet a question at hashtag America Divided, we're trying to engage and use technology, as Mark points out, to have a broad platform. I think, you know, there are another 300 people that signed up for the webcast, and we'll continue to replay this and engage in the conversation, and I want to thank folks who made this happen in the back row.
While you're going that question, you touched on the end of it. It is not just D.C., but outside of D.C., and maybe ironically used an example in D.C., my neighborhood. But in my neighborhood in D.C., when there was a proposal for a new apartment building to go up, I think many of my neighbors felt concerned about what it would have on the property value. And quite frankly, I certainly knew it would depress my property value, but we needed more housing in that neighborhood. And if you go to any local planning meeting, you know, it's 9 times out of 10, the people who come to planning meetings are there to say no. And I think it's important for people to show up to planning meetings and say, we need this housing.
So I ran for local office in Montgomery County, Maryland, in the 20th Legislative District of Silver Spring and Tacoma Park, which for those of you in the room, is about as liberal a place. I think that routinely the Green Party finishes second. It was during a period of peak development in 2006, and there was a proposed development right next to the Tacoma Metro Station. And I'm a big believer in housing by metro, because it's not just rent affordability, but you point out poverty is a lived experience. It's how you get somewhere. You can build an affordable housing on an island that you can't get anywhere, and
right,
that to me doesn't count. And build it by a metro, and that's you know, usually pretty good, assuming the metro works. And the biggest opposition was from the environmentalists,
yes,
who said there's a flock of trees on top of this metro station, and we have to save the trees. And look, I read The Lorax, okay, and I'm for the trees. But I don't think that the goal is to put the trees on top of the metro, it's to put people,
yeah,
right? And so in this, you know, it's hard to find a more liberal place. And there was tremendous opposition to this. And this is a tricky question. And so, as Mark points out, when you went to a community meeting as a local perspective political person, the people that went up The people that showed up were the people for the trees. And you had to stand up there and take a tough line and be for the non-residents.
Right.
I want the poor people who don't live here to show up. Try winning an election like that. I didn't.
Right. But before we take the next question, Mark, everybody in the audience wants to know where you live in D.C. that the property values actually went down or stayed stagnant.
They would have been up if they had built this. But actually, the property values did go down, and I luckily enough bought right at the bottom. Didn't time it that way, but sometimes
all right.
You do all
in
right.
In the back?
I'm Greg Squires from George Washington University, and I have a question for Mark regarding your take on government generally. There was a piece in the Wall Street Journal and New York Times today that pointed out that the poverty rate would be more than twice what it is today in the absence of Social Security, the Earned Income Tax Credit, the food stamp program, and other programs like this. So I guess what I want to ask you, in the absence of government, meaning the absence of fair housing laws, the absence of a court system, the absence of administrative agencies to which people can file complaints, if we dispense with all those tools of government, what are the tools that we can use to effectively address the kinds of illegal activities we saw in the film today?
Well, if there's no government, there's no illegal activities. I think that's a QED, as I guess we professors would say.
So, would you expand on that?
No, I am. I'm getting to that. In one way you're asking, the defining characteristic, and despite many libertarians being identified as individualistic, for me, I'm for voluntary collective action, which the defining characteristic in my mind of government is you are using force to gather your ends. And so my objective in society is to try to reduce the use of violence as an organizing principle in society. And most of what government does, if we're quite frank about it, is at the end of a gun, or the end of a tank, or a bomb. That is the definition of government in my mind. So if you wanted to be quite blunt about it, which I think you were looking for me to say, so if you wanted to ask me theoretically, do I think some anarchist communitarian collective is possible? Sure. Or if you're asking me, do we live in that world? No. So I'm happy to get engaged in conversations about how do we move closer to that. But I certainly think most of this we can do cooperative, peacefully together, trying to work together. If you think that there are forces that are dark, evil forces in society, what's your guarantee that they're not the ones running government? Again, almost always are.
The evil forces are us.
That's right.
We are human beings.
So
we all take after each other. We're versions of each other. Can I just tell you a quick story? It's not. When I mentioned that I flew I was a radio operator. I had the top gun. I was the guy closest to the bomb bay doors, so I could look over and I could see the bomb bay door, the bombs dropping, and I saw the bomb. And I was the one who notified the pilot. He could close the doors because the last of the bombs have left the bay. But I used to see our bombs gathering with the bombs from all the other planes, and now I'm watching it, hundreds of bombs dropping. And I would ask myself, they're not all going to hit the target, or if there indeed is a target under those clouds and everything. A bomb hits a home. What does that mean? And my answer to myself was, fuck 'em. I didn't care. And then on the way home or the next day or sometime, I asked myself if somebody came to me with a piece of paper and a pencil at that moment and said, Mr. Lear, if you sign this, you will never, ever change your mind. You will always believe it didn't matter if you killed an innocent family. I prayed I would never sign such a paper. That it was what I felt at that moment. And I have six kids I mentioned. If one of my kids was harmed by somebody else, I feel in my heart of hearts I could drive 6 hours with plenty of time to change my mind and kill the son of a bitch in front of his family. If you harmed my daughter, I don't want to be that person. I don't want to be tested either. But I pray I'm not the person who, but I am capable of those feelings. And I am also capable of any piece of transcendence that anybody else is capable
Absolutely.
Of. And I think that's true for all of us. And we've got to accept and understand who we are as human beings and what we're capable of and then start to deal with, well, now how do we take care of these kids who have no chance to do it for themselves?
I think we have time for one more question. Two more.
I'm Tanya Milton. I'm from Savannah, Georgia. I just flew in today about 12 o'clock, and I'm so excited that you guys are doing this. This is an awesome job. I just got drugged into this situation, and I'm excited that I did. A couple of things. I serve as chairman of the Planning Commission in Savannah. All of this that you're saying exists. But the first thing was I saw on the piece that there was a developer who had come in to do affordable housing. Did he get a tax incentive? Is there a way that we can offer tax incentives to these developers to come in and create affordable housing? We do that for businesses to come in and bring jobs. I don't know if that's happening, but we're considering that in Savannah. Also, you mentioned the housing and how the affordable housing that have been there, the projects, actually, they are rebuilding them now. In several areas, we have torn down what was old and displaced people, and it's taking years to get it back. And what's happening to those people while they're wandering around? We're doing a lot, though, to try to help the homeless. Well, not a lot, but we are considering the tiny houses. And the last thing is the fair housing you're talking about truly existing. And I mean, the discrimination and how you go about advertising and how you can hide behind the social media or the digital in order to say that you are reaching out to African Americans when you know that that's not really where they are. How do you address that? And from a HUD standpoint, my last thing was that, they're building. What happens when you get a developer to come in, they buy a piece of property that's been sitting there blighted, and they build out the neighborhood because what they put there tax out the other people that are living down the street when they come in and they say, well, wouldn't you rather see a development opposed to the blight that you got? And it just pushes everybody out.
Start with Mark. All of that. Work down.
Sure. You touched upon an issue that I want to talk about, and that's the displacement. And I think this is an incredibly important issue when we do redevelopment. And just to show how broad-minded I am, that I do read lots of things from the left. One of my all-time favorite books is Herbert Gann's classic Urban Villager. And again, it's about very healthy, creative, vibrant Italian-American communities in Boston that got bulldozed by the federal government. And I'll put this in perspective. I did some math a couple of weeks ago of the families that lose their home to eminent domain, half of them are African American. Mm-hmm. And we have to be very cautious when redevelopment. We've had decades of where under the banner of blight, we have destroyed vibrant neighborhoods. And I think that that's been a massive tragedy. And so maybe part of this from my perspective is, you know, I think we need to have some modesty about our ability, particularly here in Washington, to socially engineer the right outcome without having a whole lot of collateral damage in the process. And do I think we're smarter and we've learned a bit more? Sure, but I am still very, very cautious of us just pushing through here without doing incredible amount of damage. And so I do think we need to think about displacement issues. I'd go as far to say, even though it's in the Constitution, we can do eminent domain, we should be very, very cautious about ever taking anybody out of their house. If they're happy there, they're productive there, we should not be moving them.
I'm grateful for the time together. It took me 94 years, a couple of months, some hours, a couple of weeks, hours, days, minutes, seconds, just to say what I'm saying now. This second followed the last second, and it's the last second I've spent in this life. And I'm living in the now, looking at you, who caught this. Being here with me cost you every split second of your lives to get here. So I'm way ahead of you. And I've had a great afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you.
I did just want to say one thing in response to the question, because you raised a number of very, very important issues. So, yes, you can use tax incentives to promote the building of affordable housing, and it has been done effectively in some instances, but in many instances it has not, so you have to be very careful about that. And then also jurisdictions can grandfather in, or they can provide leniency for people who live in an area where the property values are rising dramatically, and provide some protections for people who can't afford to pay those increased taxes. And then last thing I'll say, because you touched on a number of fair housing issues that are very important, and I'll just reiterate my message earlier that we have to have funds to effectively enforce fair housing in America. HUD has been sufficiently underfunded, particularly for its FH&EO division, its Fair Housing and Equal Opportunity division. And one of the things that we've been pushing for at HUD, at the National Fair Housing Alliance, is for adequate funding in the appropriations process so that HUD can have the funds that it needs to effectively enforce our fair housing laws, and that includes the implementation of the Affirmatively Furthering Fair Housing Rule.
Thank you. I want to conclude by thanking both Lisa and Mark for getting on stage and debating these tough issues. I want to especially thank Norman and everybody through EPIX in the motion picture for this. Think about the conversation that was sparked by this housing segment and realize that there are 8 total segments on a variety of issues that will be premiering on September 30th. We hope you tune in there, and also tune in to future Brookings events. Thank everybody here for coming.
Thank you.